Welcome to worship on this sixth Sunday of Easter. We're glad you're worshiping with us today. Please know that no matter who you are and where you are on life's journey, you're welcome here and embraced among us to worship a loving God who welcomes us all. When you begin your in-home worship service, pause to center yourself and then hold your palms toward the computer screen or to your heart. And imagine the energy of connection. Think of the many people you love at Lakewood Congregational Church and the body of Christ throughout the world, and feel the ways in which our hearts are connected during this time. And say, may the peace of Christ be with you. May the peace of Christ be with you. Join me responsively in our call to worship. The responses will be printed on the screen. We long for community and the presence of God, in whom we live and move and have our being. This day, Christ tells us that we will never be alone. An advocate, Spirit of Truth, will share our journey, with whom we will live and create community and celebrate being. May the love of God be with you and the joy of Christ surround you. May we know the presence of the Advocate as we gather in this community of peace. May your truth lead us to the path of discipleship with deeds of bold mercy and courageous justice. As an Easter people following a risen Lord, may the life of Jesus live on in us and through us. Amen.
Since I began here at Lakewood Congregational Church, it has been a joy to get to know Allison Yonkers, the director of our Haynes Nursery School. Allison is about to take off on new adventures and isn't going to be working with us anymore here at the nursery school. And we wanted to take some time today to recognize her for all of her accomplishments, the love that she's given, the care she's given, the support she's given to not only the students, but the teachers and all of their families. So we're gonna hear from some students and we just want to applaud her for everything she's done. At the end of the week on Friday, we're gonna have, we're calling it a chalk walk, and there's gonna be sidewalk chalk by the West Clifton entrance of the church. And the students are gonna be coming at different times to write messages to Mrs. Yonkers. And you are welcome to come write messages to her. or just to come see the artwork that some of the kids have done. This is a fun way to show her our appreciation. Thank you so much, Mrs. Yonkers. We're going to miss you.
I love you, Mrs. Yonkers, and I really miss you, and I miss your hugging kisses.
Okay, Jack, your turn.
We really love you, and we miss letting go, and we're really sad that you have to leave tomorrow, but we really love your kisses and hugs, so bye.
Allison, thank you on behalf of the Haynes Board, Lakewood Congregational Church, and from my own heart for all your work with Haynes Nursery School, for your service and dedication to young children. We all wish you the very best.
Hello. I'm Sandie King, a member of LCC, and I'm a chaplain at MetroHealth Medical Center. I cover the trauma intensive care unit and the burn intensive care unit. And now, since this pandemic, I also cover a couple of our COVID units. Joanna asked me if I might share with you how my ministry has changed since this pandemic started. What's been hard about these changes? What's been beautiful about these changes? There's so much that I can say, so many stories that I can share. The first thing that I want to say is that the chaplains are present in the hospital every day. All of us are there. And we thought long and hard about this. We did some deep soul searching about the why and the what and the how. And we stayed. And I'm so grateful that we stayed. I can so clearly recall the first day we instituted the policies and procedures in response to the pandemic. The first time I realized that I had to stay at least 6 feet away from our patients, that we had to stay 6 feet away from each other as much as humanly possible. And if the diagnosis is in fact COVID, then we cannot as chaplains go into the room at all. And we minister with them if they are alert and oriented through the glass door of their rooms. Even wearing gloves, masks, gowns, no matter, it's at least 6 feet away or outside of the room because of infection control measures. That goes against every natural instinct that I have, every fiber of my being, to keep that distance. Can you imagine? Not being able to hold someone's hand as you're praying, not being able to cup someone's face as you're singing Amazing Grace to them, not being able to stroke a person's forehead or cheeks while they lay dying, or not to be able to snuggle up close to an elderly patient who is extremely hard of hearing so that you can get close enough to their ear so that they can hear you. None of that can happen now. I can tell you that families who, with rare exception, are not able to be present with their loved ones have been understanding. I'm sure you all know there's a no visitor policy, again with rare exception. They have been so appreciative of all that's being done to protect their loved one and to protect them. They understand, and they have been very heartbroken and very courageous. My ministry with families has been, for the most part, over the phone or email. Mothers send letters to me to read to their child, who was on life support after a motor vehicle collision. A family in Texas sent a couple of family photographs, beautiful photographs, for me to copy and hang in the room of their son while he recovers from his gunshot wounds. Again, everything at a distance. We cannot hold a person whose loved one has just died. We can't wrap our arm around the father who's being told that his son's injuries are non-survivable. And then there's Nurse Becca, who stood for 40 minutes next to a patient's bed in the COVID intensive care unit, holding up an iPad as his family spoke with him. They are Greek Orthodox. So they were playing Greek music and speaking in Greek to him and sharing family happenings and telling him how much they love him. Then Nurse Becca put down the iPad after almost 40 minutes and picked up the Q-tip that the priest had dipped in the holy oil, wrapped in aluminum foil, and a family member brought it to the main entrance of the hospital for me to pick up. She picked up that Q-tip, and as the son read the blessing in Greek, Becca made the sign of the cross on the patient's forehead, and then his chin, and then his cheeks. And what comfort and joy this brought to the family and to the patient. So we feel every day in the hospital what has been taken away and what has been given in its stead, what is missing and what is so very present. We see that connection is connection during this time of anxiety and fear. And even though the nature of all of this technological connection is so disembodied, I'm so grateful to have it. Can you imagine what this time would be like without cell phones and iPads and Zoom and other video conferencing methods? Can you imagine what it was like in our history without those things, when families could not be with their loved ones? And thank God, we are comforted to know that people are getting better. We celebrate that in the hospital and in our hearts. So thank you for listening to me sharing a little bit about my work with you, my ministry with you. And before I share a prayer, I'm wondering if I could just invite you to do a little bit of deep breathing with me. So if you just put your feet planted, both on the ground, and close your eyes if you're comfortable, and just take a deep breath through your nose all the way down to your belly, and then out your mouth. Feel your shoulders relax as you do that. Another deep breath through your nose. Feel your muscles just relaxing into your chair. And one more deep breath. God, we need you every moment of every day in our lives. And God, how often we forget that we cannot do life alone. We are being broken open during this time of pandemic, broken open to see, to really see and to feel our humanity, our vulnerabilities, our strengths, our creative and generous natures that can shine your love and peace within this community of Lakewood Congregational Church, this community of MetroHealth, this community of Greater Cleveland, and around the world. We pray that the healing balm of your love and light be on our patients, those who love them, our care providers, doctors, nurses, respiratory therapists, environmental services staff, food services staff, transporters, chaplains, and so many more. May faith bring strength and wisdom to their hearts and hands and heads, so they may use the gifts you have given them to take exquisite care of all those suffering. And we pray for far, far too many outside of those hospital communities who are suffering with violence, lack of proper nutrition, lack of safe shelter, lack of proper medical and mental health care, lack of someone who cares about them. All who are in need of your love, of our love. May we continue to garner the strength, the resources, and the conviction to reach far beyond our four walls of homes and church, to move out into our community in the creative and compassionate ways that you call us. And in so doing, may we bring always your healing love to those we touch. We thank you, God, for all that you have done and for all that you will do. And may we lift our voices as one as we pray as Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Today we call upon you as children of God to share in the love and work of Jesus. We, as a gathered church, as a body of Christ, continue in our day to witness and work on behalf of our Lord, returning our gifts and tithes and offerings to God. And so I invite you now, as you are able, to contribute to the work and mission of our church, or to rededicate yourself during this time to the work and mission of our community. And then will you pray with me together our prayer of dedication? May these gifts, O God, become action and intention, fulfilling Christ's commandment to love. Amen.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise God, all creatures here below. Praise God above ye heavenly hosts. Creator Christ and Holy Ghost. Amen.
John chapter 14, verses 15 through 21.
If you love me, you will keep my commandments.
And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to be with you forever. This is the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it neither sees him nor knows him. You know him because he abides with you, and he will be in you.
I'll not leave you orphaned.
I'm coming to you.
I'm coming to you.
In a little while, the world will no longer see me, but you will see me. Because I live, you also will live. On that day, you will know that I am my Father, and you in me, and I in you. They who have my commandments and keep them are those who love me, and those who love me will be loved by my Father, and I will love them and reveal myself to them.
God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts in this time be acceptable in your sight, for you are our rock and our Redeemer. Amen. Today's scripture is part of what we call the farewell discourse in the Gospel of John. Even though Lent ended several weeks ago and we went through the farewell during Holy Week, the lectionary puts parts of John's farewell discourse here, this week and next, as we near the end of the Easter season. This coming Thursday, the church celebrates the Ascension. We don't have a separate service for it, but we still celebrate it. The bodily rising of Jesus into heaven after he has revealed himself to his disciples on a number of occasions following his resurrection. Then in 2 weeks, we'll have Pentecost, the birth of the church, the lighting of flames over the heads of Christ's followers so that they have within them a new burning, a new spark to do the work of Jesus in the world. John's farewell discourse to his disciples, who are very anxious about his death, is very simple but urgent pastoral care. You are not alone. It's as simple as that. You are not alone. Jesus is assuring his companions that his imminent departure from the earth is not an abandonment, but rather a move that will pave the way for a deeper peace and a deeper connection than they have ever known before. Jesus is trying to explain to them, yes, I'm leaving, but you still will know my presence in a deep and abiding way. You have to trust me. You have to trust the one who sent me. You have to believe that I have given you everything it takes to be on this journey. You are not alone. Foundational pastoral care. This passage is reassuring and beautiful in so many ways, but I love particularly the use of the word advocate. It's the word parakletos, helper, advocate, literally one who is called alongside. Throughout the Gospel of John, we do read about the Holy Spirit many times. The Spirit descended like a dove, born again with water and the Spirit. But those times, the word is ruach in Hebrew or pneuma in Greek. Breath, wind, air, breathing. Here, Spirit is called advocate, one who is called alongside. You will not be alone, for you will have an advocate. From the time I was very young, I took such great solace in this promise that God was always with me, that Jesus was in my heart, that the Holy Spirit surrounded me and protected me, that when it was dark, I had an everlasting nightlight in my heart because of that advocate. It's the same language that gets me through these times too. In a little while, the world will no longer see me, but you will see me. Because I live, you also will live. On that day, you will know that I am in my Father, and you in me, and I in you. I am an everlasting nightlight in your heart. You probably heard me talk about the overlap of the Venn diagram. It's one of my favorite things to talk about, one of my favorite images about my faith. So here it is again. If we were to draw a Venn diagram between heaven and earth, with earth being full of human brokenness and strained relationships, greed and resentment, violence and oppression, and heaven Being this world where God's creation is whole and healed and free with every baby on every hip fat and healthy, then our job as followers of Jesus Christ is to occupy the overlap, to live in the space where heaven and earth meet each other, and to declare to people that this world is possible, that a world of beloved community with a baseline of grace and abiding presence is possible. The ascension story points to the overlap. Jesus says, I'm going to give you an advocate. I think it's like a nightlight, a soft, sweet bird, a dove, a gentle and constant embrace, a little ball of fire and healing ointment. I don't know what that advocate looks like for you, but Jesus says, I'm going to give you this to be with you forever. He says, the world cannot have it because it neither sees it nor knows it. He's talking about the part of the Venn diagram that doesn't overlap. That part of the diagram doesn't get it. The world doesn't get it. It's too far blinded by greed and selfishness and oppression. And then Jesus says, I'm going to go to a place where the world can't see me anymore. He's talking about the other side of the Venn diagram that doesn't overlap. He's going to the heaven part. And then he says, but because you live here in this overlap, you will have this advocate and you will hold it and you will see it. And you will never be alone. Those who hold my commandments and keep them are those who love me, and they are those who live here in this overlap. Now, I need you to understand that this isn't a situation where some people always live in the world and some people always live in the overlap. Our lives are fluid and we are always roaming between them. But God is always calling us here to the overlap, to the place where the advocate abides. And our job as disciples of Christ is to increase and build our lives within the overlap to whatever extent possible. And so I want to know, while we're staying safe at home, stay home, stay safe, stay connected, how are we occupying and increasing the overlap? What are you doing to keep yourself connected? Jesus says, I will not leave you orphaned. But sometimes we pull ourselves away from that promise and we feel alone. I want to tell you a story. This is a story about the ascension that originated with the Desert Fathers, but has been adapted and molded over the centuries, and this is the way I know it today. It's the way I know the story. After Jesus died, he began appearing to his friends. This, of course, usually happened when a group of them got together to talk about him, telling his jokes and remembering what Jesus taught him. On this particular day, a really large crowd of his friends had gathered. And what do you know? Jesus showed up too, and he began to teach them, saying, resist, pray for your enemies, turn the other cheek, go the extra mile, love one another, every single other. And when he had said all this, a voice from the heavens boomed, ascend. And so he did. Ascend means to rise up. He spread out his arms and he looked up to heaven with a smile and he slowly began to rise. And the disciples watched, stunned, and suddenly Mary, realizing what was happening, gave a shout, backed up and got a running start and leapt up to grab Jesus's left ankle. I'm coming too, she cried. And John, seeing what was happening, jumped and grabbed the other ankle. And Jesus, slightly concerned, stopped and looked down at them and then back up to heaven and asked, God, what do I do? And God said, ascend. And so all together, holding on to one another, lifting each other up, they all began to rise. And now the other disciples, seeing Mary and John rising with Jesus, they wanted to go too. And so suddenly all of Jesus's friends are jumping and grabbing onto their ankles, and Mary and John and Jesus reached out to pull them up until there was a small pyramid of people swinging from the sky. A little alarmed, Jesus asked again, "What do I do, God?" And the voice from heaven boomed, "Ascend." And all together, holding on to one another, lifting each other up, they all began to rise. Then people from all over, folks who had seen Jesus' miracles or heard him preach, people who had seen the friends of Jesus feed the hungry and show kindness, they began to jump up and grab on to the lowermost disciples. And slowly, all together, holding on to one another, lifting each other up, they all began to rise. But a little girl way at the bottom shouted, "Stop, wait, I want to bring my dog." And Jesus, way up at the top, yells back down, "Try to hurry. I don't know how this works." And so the little girl, still scanning the horizon, reached out and grabbed a tree, and the branch held on tight. And everyone kept rising. And the tree began to rise too. And it looked like the tree would be uprooted, but the tree curled its toes and held on tight to the earth, and the earth started to rise too. But it reached out to the sea, and the sea grabbed hold with its waves and held on tight, and no one let go. And slowly, all together, holding on to one another, lifting each other up, the whole world was drawn closer to God. The whole world was drawn closer to God. When we're committed to holding on, that overlap expands and expands and expands, and heaven and earth are the same. God's creation is whole and healed and free. Every baby on every hip is fat and healthy. Beloved community with a baseline of grace and abiding presence is happening here as the world is drawn closer to God. Friends, I don't know what is happening to our world right now. I don't know what tomorrow will bring. I don't know when we'll embrace each other again. I don't know when senseless violence will end and when every person will be fully aware of their endless love and belonging. I don't know when and I don't know how, but I know that the Advocate, that the Holy Spirit, that the Paraclete, that the Holy Spirit is giving us an opportunity to draw closer, to widen the overlap, to draw a new picture, to weave a new garment, to create a better world, to bless this moment beyond our understanding. I know that. Open your hearts to it. Reach out your arms and grab on to that Advocate and pull her into your heart. I want to end with a poem from Jan Richardson, whose work I've read to you often. This is a blessing for Ascension Day. It was written in 2013, and I cannot tell you how well it has aged until you hear it. It's called Stay, a Blessing for Ascension Day by Jan Richardson. I know how your mind rushes ahead, trying to fathom what could follow this. What will you do? Where will you go? How will you live? You will want to outrun that grief. You will want to keep turning toward the horizon, watching for what was lost to come back. to return to you and never leave again. For now, hear me when I say all you need to do is to still yourself, to turn toward one another, to stay. Wait and see what comes to fill the gaping hole in your chest. Wait with your hands open to receive what could never come except to what is empty and hollow. You cannot know it now, cannot even imagine what lies ahead. But I tell you, the day is coming when breath will fill your lungs as it never has before. And with your own ears, you will hear words coming to you new and startling. You will dream dreams, and you will see the world ablaze with blessing. Wait for it. Still yourself. Stay. Amen. Now leave this time of worship refreshed and hopeful. Let love be true and freely given. And may you be encouraged and blessed by the Advocate whose love warms and surrounds you like the sun, believing that God is with us always, as close as our beating hearts. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, one God, Mother of us all. Amen.